Welcome to part three of our glycolysis series. In this section, we will focus on one of the major regulatory steps in the glycolytic pathway, the conversion of fructose-6-phosphate to fructose-1,6-bisphosphate by the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1. We have already covered the reaction mechanism of the phosphoglucose isomerase enzyme in an earlier lecture on carbohydrate structure. Please refer back to this video tutorial for details about the isomerase mechanism. In this section, we really want to focus on the third step in the glycolytic pathway, the conversion of fructose-6-phosphate to fructose-1,6-bisphosphate by the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1, or PFK1. It is interesting to note that all of the major enzymes regulated in glycolysis are kinases. The last lecture focused on the role of the hexokinase isozymes in regulating glycolysis in different tissues within the body. This lecture will focus on PFK1, and our final lecture on glycolysis will cover the third major regulatory element in the glycolysis path, the metabolic step requiring the action of pyruvate kinase. So there are three major regulatory elements for glycolysis: the hexokinase step, the PFK1 step, and the pyruvate kinase step. The PFK1 reaction is the first irreversible reaction of glycolysis. It also represents the committed step within the pathway. The phosphorylation of fructose-6-phosphate to fructose-1,6-bisphosphate commits the fructose-1,6-bisphosphate to continue going through the glycolytic pathway. It cannot be utilized for any other purpose at that point. Fructose-6-phosphate, on the other hand, could be converted back to glucose-6-phosphate and used for many different purposes, such as glycogen synthesis, nucleotide synthesis, or hexosamine synthesis. Because of the committed nature of this step, phosphofructokinase 1 is one of the most important control points in the glycolytic pathway. The PFK1 enzyme is composed of a tetramer that contains different combinations of three types of subunits: muscle, M, liver, L, and platelet, P. The composition of the PFK1 tetramer differs according to the tissue type it is present in. For example, mature muscle expresses only the M isozyme. Therefore, the muscle PFK1 is composed solely of homotetramers of M4. The liver and kidneys express predominantly the L isoform. In erythrocytes, both M and L subunits randomly tetramerize to form M4, L4, and the three hybrid forms of the enzymes ML3, M2L2, M3L. As a result, the kinetic and regulatory properties of the various isozyme pools are dependent on subunit composition. Tissue-specific changes in PFK activity and isoenzymic content contribute significantly to the diversities of glycolytic and gluconeogenic rates, which have been observed for different tissues. PFK1 is an allosteric enzyme and has a structure similar to that of hemoglobin, insofar as it's a dimer of a dimer. One half of each dimer contains the ATP binding site, shown in dark blue, whereas the other half, the substrate binding site, fructose-6-phosphate, or F6P, shown in red, as well as a separate allosteric binding site that is occupied by ADP. All isoforms of phosphofructokinase 1 are activated by the allosteric binding of ADP or AMP. This indicates a low energy state within the cell and the need for glycolysis and energy production and energy generation. Allosteric inhibitors include high levels of ATP and citrate. Note that ATP is a substrate of this enzyme and has a normal substrate binding site indicated in dark blue above. When there is enough ATP present that it can also bind allosterically to the enzyme, it will act as an inhibitor. Citrate, the first molecule in the Krebs cycle, citric acid cycle, can also act as an allosteric inhibitor of phosphofructokinase 1. High levels of citrate indicate high energy load within the cell, and that no more pyruvate is needed to generate energy through oxidative phosphorylation. We are going to see that fructose 2,6-bisphosphate is predominantly a regulator of PFK1 in liver cells, where it serves as an activator. But before we discuss the formation and use of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate and its role in the regulation of phosphofructokinase 1, let's review opposing glucose utilization and production pathways within the liver. Two opposing pathways within the liver are glycolysis, the breakdown of glucose, and gluconeogenesis, the formation of glucose. It would be unproductive to have both of these pathways operating at the same time. Thus, if one pathway is needed, then the other one needs to be turned off. We previously saw this same type of control for glycogenesis, the formation of glycogen, and glycogenolysis, the breakdown of glycogen. When one of these pathways is upregulated, the other needs to be downregulated. In the resting state of the liver, when blood glucose levels are in the homeostatic range, gluconeogenesis will be shut off, as it is very expensive to make glucose, and the liver will only invest in making glucose if blood glucose levels fall critically low, for example, during extreme exercise or long-term fasting. In the resting state, the liver will use the glycolytic pathway to supply normal levels of ATP energy for the maintenance of housekeeping processes. Glycogenesis and glycogenolysis will be in balance or equilibrium as needed to augment the supply of glucose entering the system from the bloodstream. If glucose in the bloodstream drops below homeostatic levels, the pancreas will release glucagon and begin this hormone signaling pathway that causes the liver to release glucose into the bloodstream. Thus, glucagon signaling leads to the downregulation of glycolysis and glycogenesis, so it can shunt glucose pools to the bloodstream. It also leads to an increase in glycogenolysis, or the breakdown of glycogen. If the demand is high enough for glucose in the bloodstream, liver cells will also turn on gluconeogenesis pathways and make glucose from non-carbohydrate precursors. This is an energy-intensive pathway. The major site for gluconeogenesis is the liver, with a small amount also taking place in the kidney. Little gluconeogenesis takes place in the brain, skeletal muscle, or heart muscle. It just does not make energetic sense to do that. It costs more energy for cells to make glucose than they can get from breaking it down in oxidative phosphorylation. This cost can be dealt with by doing it in the liver and then releasing it into the bloodstream to fuel activities in the brain, heart, and skeletal muscle. So to do this, glucagon stimulates that lovely signaling pathway you are all now familiar with. It activates the G protein coupled receptor, which in turn activates a downstream G protein. Adenylate cyclase is activated and produces the second messenger, cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP binds with the Krebs protein and activates transcription of proteins involved in gluconeogenesis. Cyclic AMP also binds with protein kinase A and upregulates the activity of glycogen phosphorylase, resulting in the breakdown of glycogen. It also downregulates the activities of glycogen synthase to inhibit glycogenesis. In this section, we will also see how protein kinase A activation will downregulate the glycolytic pathway as well. The activated G protein stimulates the adenylate cyclase to produce cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP then binds with protein kinase A and the cyclic AMP response element binding protein, or CREB. Activated CREB will bind with DNA in the nucleus and mitochondria and upregulate the expression of genes involved with gluconeogenesis. Protein kinase A will phosphorylate downstream targets that downregulate glycolysis and glycogenesis, while upregulating glycogenolysis, again to free up glucose and return it to the bloodstream. Regulation of the glycolytic pathway in response to this signaling occurs through the regulation of the phosphofructokinase 2, fructose bisphosphate phosphatase 2 enzyme. Activity of this enzyme is controlled through the protein kinase A signaling cascade. This enzyme is responsible for phosphorylating fructose 6-phosphate to the fructose 2,6-bisphosphate form. Note that this bisphosphate form of fructose is different than the bisphosphate form utilized in the glycolytic pathway. The glycolytic pathway requires 1,6-bisphosphate that is formed from the phosphofructokinase 1 enzyme, or step 3 of the glycolytic pathway. This is a separate enzyme altogether and not involved directly in the glycolytic pathway. However, we noted in the past slide that fructose 2,6-bisphosphate can serve as an allosteric activator of the phosphofructokinase 1 enzyme. The PFK2-FBPase2 enzyme is a dual-purpose enzyme. Half of the protein has kinase activity and can phosphorylate fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. The other half of the enzyme contains a phosphatase that can cleave off the phosphate group from the 2 position and restore fructose 6-phosphate. Note that both activities are not functional at the same time. The enzyme activity is determined by phosphorylation state. When the protein is dephosphorylated, the PFK2 enzyme is active, leading to the production of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. This molecule can then bind with PFK1 in the glycolytic pathway and increase its activity. If the protein is phosphorylated by protein kinase A during glucagon signaling, the FBPase is activated and the kinase activity is inhibited. This leads to the dephosphorylation of fructose at the 2 position and release of fructose 6-phosphate. As shown in the last slide, the PFK2-FBPase2 enzyme is responsible for phosphorylating fructose 6-phosphate to the fructose 2,6-bisphosphate form. Note that this bisphosphate form of fructose is different than the bisphosphate form used in the glycolytic pathway. The glycolytic pathway requires fructose 1,6-bisphosphate that is formed from the PFK1 enzyme, or step 3 of the glycolytic pathway. If there is a lot of fructose 6-phosphate around, for example, you just drank high fructose corn syrup in your sugary energy drink, it can support the formation of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate by PFK1 and the production of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate by PFK2. Fructose 2,6-bisphosphate will then bind to PFK1 and supercharge it for converting fructose 6-phosphate into fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. However, during glucagon signaling, you need to shut down this fast-track upregulation of PFK1 by fructose 2,6-bisphosphate and turn down the glycolytic pathway. To do this, protein kinase A will phosphorylate the PFK2-FBPase2 enzyme and alter its activity. The kinase activity is inhibited, and the phosphorylase activity is turned on. This slide gives a summary of this control pathway. In the presence of glucagon, protein kinase A will phosphorylate the PFK2-FBPase2 enzyme, causing the kinase activity to be switched off and the phosphatase activity to be switched on. Dephosphorylation of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate recovers fructose 6-phosphate Fructose-6-phosphate can go through the reverse isomerase reaction and recover glucose-6-phosphate. Glucose-6-phosphate will then be transported to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, where it will be dephosphorylated, and then free glucose can be released back into the blood. Ultimately, the result of glucagon signaling is the downregulation of glycolysis. Note that this is downregulated, not silenced. The opposite holds true for insulin signaling. High insulin concentrations result in the activation of protein phosphatases and the dephosphorylation of the PFK2-FBPase2 enzyme. In the dephosphorylated state, PFK2 activity is high and the FBPase2 activity is low, which will stimulate PFK1 in the glycolytic pathway. Who knew that life would be so complicated?